In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we greet you today as we join together to worship God. And I would like to introduce my mom, Lou Ann Jordan, and her friend, Bud DeCaro, who are with us this morning from Commonwealth. And we have a whole group of Presbyterians from Pennsylvania, Virginia, and Maryland. And they're gathering this weekend here and wanted to come and worship with us, and we're delighted to have you join us today. It's good to be together with you as we worship God. And as we do, I want to remind you of a couple of things. Today is Reach Sunday, so if you would be willing to take a bag and deliver it or two to someone in the community that you'd be assigned to, we'd appreciate that. Again, I want to thank David and Donna for their work, and you'll notice the pictures on the bulletin and inside depict the themes during Lent that we're dealing with, and David is the one who pulled those together. And so David, thank you very much. And David and Donna are going to be doing a special program of art at the Methodist Church on March the 15th. On a Friday night at 7 p.m., so you're invited to be a part of that. Again, I also want to thank Debbie for the decorations and getting us set up for the Lenten season, and also for Ruth and Marta, who've done so much in helping get ready for the Lenten season, and for our children, giving you some rocks. Thank you for your ministry to us. It's time for our dinner together again. We need volunteers. We need peanut butter cookies, and peanut butter recipes are in the narthex for the cookies if you would like to make some. We need hamburger buns and fresh bags of fresh celery and carrots. And we have been serving about 150 people each Thursday that we do this, and I think all the other churches that join in and do it on their nights are about the same. So it's quite a wonderful ministry for those who need help with food. So I hope you'll consider being a part of this. I'd encourage you to talk to Randy if you would like to volunteer for this. We can always use some more help. Let me remind you of the Easter flowers that will be using to decorate our sanctuary during Easter. They are $15 each, and you can purchase one in memory or in honor of someone. But we need to have that by Wednesday the 20th. So go ahead and sign up. You can sign up online or talk to Misty in the office. By the way, Misty is away today. She is running for her life. She's in some kind of marathon. But Carl is starting his debut with us, working with us back in the PA. So thanks, Carl. He was baptized by fire last week when nothing was working. I always feel sorry for people in AV that when it won't work. But they finally, at the end of the service, figured it out that it was the solar battery needed charging. So hopefully everything's working this week, Carl. That's a rough way to start. Our faith builders are going to be having a bake sale after Sunday worship on the 17th to raise money for the children's program. So please remember that, and don't forget your checkbooks. Our youth program needs volunteers for the egg hunt, and that will be after the Sunday worship on Easter morning. And we also need some donations of plastic eggs and candy to go in that. You do not need the plastic eggs. All right, okay, very good. So we don't need eggs, so keep your eggs at home. But we do need candy to go in the eggs. So I hope you'll remember that. We have a lot going on in the church these days, and it's It's an exciting time for the church. And again, I want to say, that when you're in an interim period, it's a very anxious time for a church, but it's also a healthy time because it affords the laity to really exercise their ministry. And you have done that extremely well. You all have stepped up and are doing a wonderful job. So thank you very much for how you are working together in this time of transition. Let us join together in prayer as we begin our worship. Oh, gracious God, we live in a harsh, harsh world, quick to condemn and destroy, and it hurts. But we come into this place this morning because we sense a new word from you, a word that we don't get in the world very often, a word of grace and love, understanding, compassion. And we thank you so much for that word in Christ. And so we open our hearts and our minds to you, knowing that you are our true reality. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Please join me responsively in the call to worship, which is taken from Psalms 19. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. They are more desirable than gold and sweeter than honey. Let us worship God. Please stand if you're able for our opening hymn, number 347. Please join us in the prayer of confession. God of mercy, You sent Jesus Christ to seek and save the lost. We confess that we have strayed from you and turned aside from your ways. We are misled by pride, for we see ourselves pure when we are stained and great when we are small. We have failed in love, neglected justice, and ignored your truth. Have mercy, O God, and forgive our sins. Return us to the path of righteousness through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Our lectionary text, or our scripture text for this morning, is the woman caught in adultery. And I urge you to remember the words of Jesus to her. I do not condemn you. For Jesus said often, I do not condemn you, but I come to bring life and bring it in fullness. Receive now the mercy of God's grace through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Repeat to the Father and to the Son. Was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated, and would the children please come forward for our children's sermon. Thank you. You made me a badge. Thank you very much. What's that?
We've been learning to be disciples.
Oh. They got to choose someone they thought was a disciple.
Well, thank you very much. That's awfully sweet of y'all. I appreciate it. Well, y'all must be Baptists. You're sitting in the back pew here. Well, anyway. I want us to think about a story in the Bible today. It's a woman who's caught red-handed. She's broken the law. And they got her all, surrounded her. They have stones like these. And they're about ready to stone her to death, because that's what they did back then, you know.
You're like my fireplace made out of stone?
Uh-huh. Like your fireplace made out of stone.
Yep,
big rocks, and they were going to stone her, and Jesus stepped in. He knelt down and started writing on the ground. Nobody knew probably what he was writing, but maybe some people saw it, and we're not sure what he was writing. But then he says, let the person here who has no sin cast the first stone. Now, the problem is that we all know we all sin, right? I mean, if you're honest with yourself, we all know we're sinners. So we don't really have much room to be condemning other people. And I can still remember when I was in junior high, and we had a young boy from Germany that came, moved to our country, and he came to the school. But he had been all his life in a school of just boys. He'd never been around girls. He was scared of them. And he was uncomfortable. And guess what they did? They made fun of him. So did the guys. And I think back now, what a miserable time he must have had in our school. And you know, it was a tragedy. Because the world can be cruel like that. When you make a mistake, they're ready to stone you to death. So it's important that we remember that Jesus said, I didn't come to condemn you. You're a mess. You're sinners, all of you. But Jesus doesn't condemn us. He loves us and wants to forgive us
and to free us, and He wants us to know His love. So I hope you'll remember that, and that means that we ought to be the kind of people that when people mess up around us, we know how to forgive and love them. So today the rock is that symbol to remind us that we don't want to throw rocks at people. We want to throw love and compassion at people, like Jesus did. Can you remember that? It's going to make your head bleed. That's right. And we don't want anybody's head to bleed. So don't throw your rocks, okay? All right, why don't we have a word of prayer? Lord, thank You so much for Your love that always is with us. Even when we mess up, You love us. You care for us. And we give You our thanks. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, amen. Okay, you can go to Children's Church. I want to thank Marissa and Uzi for the wonderful job they do with our children each week. Grace, you want to go? She just can't get enough. It's good to see you this morning as we join together in worship and we bring with us those people in our hearts and on our hearts that are going through a difficult time. And we want to continue to remember Marta's friend, father-in-law, who's on our prayer list. We want to remember Charlotte and Pat, Andra. Andra got some not so good word, but some hope too. So she's struggling with that, but we want to continue to remember her. Andrea Jackson, Debbie and Foss and Elaine. And I talked with Tom Ryan. He had a stroke and he's doing really well. He hopefully will have no lasting ramifications for that, but we want to keep Reverend Ron in our prayers and our thoughts. Are there other concerns that you would share with us today? If not, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Oh, Lord, we thank You for Your love that is what creates us and gives us life. But we come this morning confessing that we're not quite wired for it. We confess that our vision of power is the power to overcome, to rule, to win, to lord over others. And that's just not the way Jesus was. It's not the way Your love works. We need to be rewired. And we pray that that will happen during this Lenten season. As we come before You and open our lives to You, help us to see ourselves in truth and honesty, but help us to see ourselves and our world through the eyes of Jesus and see how broken we really are. But help us to also see the love of Jesus. And may that compassion fill our lives and compel us to become persons of love and compassion and grace for all those around us. We lift up our brothers and sisters that we've mentioned and those that we bring that are heavy on our hearts today. We pray, oh Lord, that they might know the reality of Your love and presence that's at work in them and with them now. We continue to lift up our church as we go through this anxious time without a pastor, and we pray that You would lead and guide us and direct us and empower us, but most of all, help us to know that You are at work in what we are doing. And Lord, we pray that Your Spirit will guide the committee that's working to secure a pastor and guide them and direct them and give them wisdom and understanding. We thank you for this place of worship. We thank you that we are here together as brothers and sisters in your grace and love. Help us not to take that lightly, for we come today to worship you and to remember Jesus Christ our Lord, and in his name we pray. Amen.
Our first scripture reading this morning is from Psalms 19, and I'm reading from the Good News Translation. And it's titled, God's Glory in Creation and God's Law. How clearly the sky reveals God's glory, how plainly it shows what he has done. Each day announces it to the following day. Each night repeats it to the next. No speech or words are used, no sound is heard. Yet their message goes out to all the world and is heard to the ends of the earth. God made a home in the sky for the sun. It comes out in the morning like a happy bridegroom, like an athlete eager to run a race. It starts at one end of the sky and goes across to the other. Nothing can hide from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect. It gives new strength. The commandments of the Lord are trustworthy, giving wisdom to those who lack it. The laws of the Lord are right, and those who obey them are and give understanding to the mind. Reverence for the Lord is good. It will continue forever. The judgments of the Lord are just. They are always fair. They are more desirable than the finest gold. They are sweeter than the purest honey. They give knowledge to me, your servant. I am rewarded for obeying them. None of us can see our own errors. Deliver me, Lord, from hidden faults. Keep me safe also from willful sins. Don't let them rule over me. Then I shall be perfect and free from the evils of sin. May the words and my thoughts be acceptable to you, O Lord, my refuge and my redeemer. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Now, I know there's got to be some more Baptists in this group than this. How wonderful we are blessed with this choir, and I think that's one of my favorite songs. So thank y'all very much for a wonderful message and done so well. Today, we continue our Lenten journey that we're using our rocks as a source to kind of focus our attention. We focused on the first week on the covenant of God written in stone and remembered how that tablet was broken into pieces and how we break that covenant, yet God's covenant was written in stone and still is for us. And then last week we talked about the stone that was rejected. We often refer to that as Jesus, but if you go back to the Psalms, it was the Israelites that were the cornerstone. And Jesus reminded them of that, and then he said that he was the cornerstone that was rejected. Today, we use the stone again. Sticks and stones. Hear the word of God. Then each of them went home while Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. And early in the morning, he came again to the temple. And all the people came to him. And he sat down and he began to teach them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. And making her stand before all of them, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the very act of committing adultery. Now in the law of Moses," that means in the Bible, "and the law of Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now what do you say?" And they said this to test him so that they might have some charge to bring against him. But Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. And when they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." And once again he bent down and wrote in the ground, and when they heard it, they went away, one by one. In other words, they snuck away, beginning with the elders. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him, and Jesus straightened up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" And she said, "No one, sir." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go your way, and from now on, do not sin." And this is the reading of God's word. Thanks be to God. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Biggest lie ever told. If you were a chubby little boy, not that I was. I was once, you would find this hard to believe, I was once told by a girl that I was so skinny the wind was going to blow me away. I have to admit that didn't hurt me. I'd love to hear that again. But if you were a bit chubby and someone called you fatty, you know what a lie this is. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. What a crazy, stupid thing that is. If you're waiting in line to be picked for some sport and you hear someone say, "Well, don't pick Mike. He couldn't catch a ball if it hit him in the stomach. Get Jack." Then you know what a lie these words are. If you were called lazy or stupid, you would go to your room, but inside your spirit was broken, as surely as somebody whacked you with a stick. Consider our story this morning. What is it that we are supposed to get from this story about Jesus? I'd like to suggest to you that it's an image of power at work. For instance, there's the power of position. The Pharisees had the power. Let me remind you why the Pharisees came into existence. They actually came into existence during what we call the Intertestament period, before the New Testament was written. The Israelites, about 400 years before that, the Israelites had just gone through
their captivity, and they were shattered by that. And one of the things that came to them is that this was God's punishment of them because they were unfaithful. And the Pharisees grew out of the desire to never let that happen again. We're going to be so faithful, it can never happen again. And so, boy, you ain't never seen anybody get as focused as they were. They came up with not only the laws of the Bible that they looked at, but they came up with over 600 new laws to make sure that they didn't break that law, you know? They were bound and determined they were going to be faithful no matter what. And so these Pharisees, well, they were kind of like the keepers of the faith. They were gatekeepers of religion. They were respected, and they were seen as the seat of authority. And, you know, to be sure, every society needs some guarding. There's a lot of sick stuff going on today when you look around us. We're bombarded with it when we look at TV. We live in a sick world. And our country is so broken right now. We're messed up, people. Messed up. But the thing is, those who feel that they are in a position to guard, whether it's to guard the faith or guard the church or guard the country, well, they can be some of the most blind people in the world. There's a harsh warning to those who think that they are in positions of authority and power. There's a great danger here, because it's easy for those who believe that themselves to be right and others to be wrong, that they actually become part of the evil that they're trying to get rid of. This pathway of setting ourselves over others as though we have not sinned can take us down some pretty dark, evil paths. Consider the humiliation of this woman. She probably was dragged out, was naked, humiliated. She was guilty as she could be. No question about that. The law was pretty clear. The Bible was pretty clear. They thought they had Jesus in a real bind. And I suppose that they did. But instead, what we get is a picture of Jesus reaching down to this woman who was hurting, who was broken, who was shamed. And he wished her no further humiliation. This means something, folks. He did not want to stone her. He did not want to condemn her. He did not want to destroy her. You see, this is a picture of cruelty. Cruelty and blindness of the Pharisees. And it happens to all of us when we get so focused on the blindness and the evil of others, we close our eyes to our own darkness and our own sin. And Jesus pretty clearly confronts those Pharisees with this reality. Let any one of you who has never sinned cast the first stone, because the truth is, there is no one. Yeah. And I like Mike Yucconelli. He has a church for people who are messed up, which is really what every church is, isn't it? We're messed up. Even we Christians, we're messed up. And the worst thing that can happen in the world is for us to not see that. And the best way for that to happen is for us to focus on those who are more messed up than me. It's the way it works. In an article for the Wall Street Journal, researcher Jonah Lehrer says that people are really nice when they're climbing up the social ladder, but once they start getting to the top, they become a beast. And he writes, as one business professor concluded, it's an incredibly consistent effect. When you give people power, they basically start acting like fools. They flirt inappropriately. They tease in a hostile fashion. They become totally impulsive. Some have even compared the feeling of power to brain damage, noting that people with lots of authority tend to behave like people with neurological patients who have a damaged frontal lobe. You know what that frontal lobe is? It's to give you some filters. It's to give you the capacity to evaluate and judge what you're saying and doing. Well, people in power lose that, he says. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words cut deeper than any stone can hurt. And in this story, I think Jesus is warning us about the power of our tongue. He's warning us, as James warned us, about the what he calls the most powerful muscle in our body, the tongue. Can be incredibly wonderful, and it can be incredibly evil and destructive. And our Lenten journey is about taking a moment to stop and examine how we have used our tongue, how we've used our life in the face of those who are broken and hurt, those who are struggling with life, you know, those messed up people like you and me. But there's also another picture of power here. It's the picture of the power of force. Not only do we use our words, but we use our policies and our actions and our ideology, even our theology, to destroy and defeat people. Historian Garrett Fagan has pointed out that the Roman world, when it encountered Christianity, had a very different view of the world than what they were hearing from some Christians. They believed that human dignity did not exist. They believed that the large population of people were seen as, well, inherently worthless. Weak members of society were objects not of compassion, but of derision. And more than most, Romans lionized strength over weakness, victory over defeat, dominion over obedience. And losers paid a harsh price and got what they deserved. And resistors were dealt with ruthlessly. Roman politics became a ruthless game of total winners and abject losers. As I was reading that, I was thinking, well, that describes us today, doesn't it? How are we any different than the Roman world? We believe in the power of might, the power to overcome, to rule over, to defeat, destroy even. They were willing to sacrifice this woman, to stone her to death. They weren't about to hurt her. They were going to kill her. They even used the words of Scripture to impose their will. You need to chew on that for a while, folks. Coercive power often not only seeks to diminish another person, it seeks to destroy them. And that is out of the realm of God's will in this world. This world only knows of a power of brute force. Jesus stands as a stark contrast that is not real power. You want to know what real power is? It's in this story too. There's an image of what real power is. It's the power of Christ, who did not use sticks and stones, but compassion. Who did not reject people who were broken. He welcomed them in. And this means something for you and me. God's answer to the problem of evil is compassion and grace, not destruction, not brutal power, not ruling it over. Reconciliation, not destruction, that's God's will in this world. His disciples are not to buy into this world's idea of power, but I'm afraid to say that the church has often bought into it, and you have bought into it. I've bought into it. We've all bought into the world's idea of power, and this passage is saying that's not power. If you want to see power, you look at Christ. Jesus once said that, I give you a new commandment that you love one another as I have loved you. What's the one thing that people look at when they look at the church today? Oh, look at those people, how they love each other. Sure. That's not what they say. Look at that church, how divided they are, how broken they are, how cruel they can be. We're to be a people not defined by sticks and stones, but we are to be a people that are defined by compassion and love and reconciliation. That's who we are. That's our DNA. It's who Christ came to be an image for us to understand and know what God's will is for our life. So the next time you win, just realize you could be very wrong. So this parable is really about power. It's your power. It's your tongue. You have the power to humiliate, destroy, and tear others down around you, or you have the power to lift people up. You have the power to be critical and negative, to break people's spirit, or you have the power of compassion and love to lift them up. In your workplace, you have the power to create a place of grace or a place of dissension and stress. You're standing in line at the store and that person's checking you out is rude and not paying attention to what they're doing. And you have the power in that moment to turn this into something really bad, to up the ante on the evil in that moment. Or you have the power to somehow interject some grace. I don't know how you're going to do it, but you have the power. You walk into the church and someone makes a comment that you think, a little bit edgy today, you know. And you have the power. You can come back at them with a quick little smart quip. And you can turn a little uncomfortable moment into a church crisis. Or you can act in compassion. Fred Craddock tells the story of, I love the story. He went back to East Tennessee where he grew up in Gatlinburg. And one evening he and his wife were dining in a restaurant overlooking the Great Smoky Mountains when they saw a very distinguished older gentleman moving from table to table greeting people. And being a stranger on vacation, they did not realize who he was. And they kind of resented the intrusion of the man going around from table to table. But upon learning that Craddock taught, was a professor of preaching in Oklahoma, the guest replied to him, you know, I've got a preacher story to tell you. And I'm sure Craddock said, oh my gosh, here we go again. And he pulled up a chair, sat down with them, which is pretty bodacious, I guess. He said, I was just born a few miles from here across the mountains. My mother was not married at the time, and the reproach that fell on her soon fell on me as a little boy. They had a name for me when I started school, and it was not nice. It caused me to stay to myself at recess and lunch because the taunts cut me so deeply. And even worse was to go to town with my mother on Saturday afternoon and feel all those eyes looking and piercing through me with the question, whose child are you? When I was about 12 years old, a new preacher came to town and came to our little church, and so I began to attend because of his eloquence and his power, and I always slipped in late and left early because I didn't want to deal with people's looks and their comments. I was still that little boy cringing inside. And the preacher one Sunday called him and said, "What is a boy like you doing in a place like this?" You can imagine all the stuff that started firing off inside of him. But one Sunday, the benediction was over before I realized it, and I found myself before this preacher who started off like that, but he caught me by surprise. He says, "Who are you, son? Whose boy are you?" Now, you can imagine what this is setting off inside of this older man now. And then he broke a smile, and he said, "Wait a minute. I know who you are. I see the family resemblance. You are a son of God." And he patted me on the rump, which probably was not the best thing to do. But it was a pat of encouragement. And he said, "Boy, you've got quite an inheritance. Go and get it." Changed his life. Craddock says that man is Ben Hooper. He was elected as, I think, the governor on one occasion, but elected to office the rest of his life. Very popular, well known. Ben Hooper, a beloved son of God. That's who he was. Sometimes people need other people to help them see. Instead, what they get is people with rocks who are willing to confirm you ain't nobody. This morning, you have a stone in your hand. I invite you to consider how you've used your power, your tongue. It's the real power in this world. You've got it. But you must be diligent and smart and faithful to Jesus Christ to use your tongue as a source of life. Otherwise, it will burn through people everywhere you go. Therefore, consider your power. Maybe there's someone that you have lashed out in your life. Maybe there's some moment that you remember that you've not been an instrument of grace. I invite you to come forward. As we give our offerings unto the Lord and we give our life unto God, bring your rock and come and place it at the foot of the cross and make your confessions to God. And may God help us learn to forgive. As you put your rock down here, remember how Jesus said upon that cross, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." Amen. Would you come and bring your offerings and your rocks? I don't know. I'll look. Thank you.
Almighty God, we bring our lives and our offerings unto you, not only in praise to you, but also with the desire to be instruments of your grace and love in this world. So where there is pain and brokenness and suffering and heartache, may we bring life, hope, compassion, and grace. Even with these gifts, use them to glorify your name and make known your many deeds among us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Would you join together as we confess our faith unto God through the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He went into heaven. He sitteth on the right hand of God, Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. My brothers and sisters, I invite you to come to the table of our Lord.
It's good to see each of you today. For our guests, we're delighted that you're here, and we hope you receive some word of God's grace and love for you. And sorry you didn't get a badge, but it's good. But if you're a visitor, we do have a gift for you. Not quite as good as a badge, but I want to invite all of you to take a moment to sit down, and as after I give the benediction, just to enjoy what is prepared for us as a postlude, because we appreciate what you do all the time. Hey, I know who you are. You're a beloved child of God. I recognize you. And there are people all over the world that need somebody to say that to them. It's you. So go forth and be instruments and disciples of Jesus Christ, that others may know that they too truly are beloved children of God. Amen. Good to see you from home. God bless you. Well, it's good to see you anyway.